president's constitutional obligation as part of the orderly transfer of power to a new administration. General Kelly has answered all of the committee's advanced questions and has provided all the information required for this for us to hold this hearing. I can't say how grateful I am that that occurred. It was going to be an awkward moment when I was going to have to object to this hearing because the Office of Government Ethics or the FBI check had not been completed. But I'm pleased to report that all was completed and I've had a chance to review all of that information, and I'm very appreciative of that, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, General Kelly. Thank you for your service to this country, and most importantly, thank you for being willing to serve again. It's very important that people stand up when their country calls, and I appreciate your willingness to do that. You've been asked to serve as the fifth Secretary of Homeland Security. The Department of Homeland Security has tremendous responsibility to protect our homeland, its people, and its infrastructure. At this moment in our history, I cannot emphasize enough the need to protect our critical infrastructure, whether it's electric grids, public transportation, or power plants. We need to understand what steps you will take to defend that infrastructure against intrusion and harm. Our intelligence community, of which DHS is a vital part of, is among the finest in the world. I would argue it is the finest in the world. It is made up of dedicated public servants, including members of our military. In order for these people to do their job of protecting Americans in an increasingly challenging environment, they need the support of our government all the way to the top. I want to understand whether you will take intelligence seriously and engage with the people whose job it is to give us good information so that we can make better decisions and that so the president-elect can make better decisions. In your answers to the committee's questions before this hearing, you said that drug demand in the United States is causing much of the violence in Central and South America, and that this violence is the major reason for the large number of people moving illegally from that area to the United States. The issues underlying border security are complex, but one thing is clear. Many of the people coming across the border aren't trying to sneak in under the fence or evade the border patrol. They are seeking refuge from the incredible violence in their home countries. I know that your experience at Southcom will help you in developing a comprehensive, inclusive approach to addressing immigration and border issues. I was also encouraged to see you discuss the necessity of engaging law enforcement, medical treatment and rehabilitation, and local communities in a comprehensive drug demand reduction campaign that includes the opioid epidemic as a big driver of heroin use. If you are confirmed, I hope that this will remain at the top of your priority list. Another major component of protecting the homeland is the department's counterterrorism efforts that you are very familiar with your experience as an important leader in our military. In today's environment, effective counterterrorism efforts require using existing and new technology, as well as other tools to counter evolving adversaries across shifting geographic borders. I plan to ask how you will address this challenge in new and innovative ways. I also hope that you will employ the same thoughtful and multifaceted approach to counterterrorism as in your proposal to address the challenges at our border. Recent events have shown us that terrorism has many faces. We have to get at root causes of extremism and also must ensure that people in our communities feel empowered to report concerns. I hope to hear from you today that you understand that in our fight against violent extremism, it's not singular in its focus, and that you will fight against any narrative that encourages committing crimes against any Americans based on hate or country of origin. As members of this committee, we also have a constitutional responsibility to conduct oversight of taxpayer dollars. This is one of my favorite areas. I can tell you right now that if you are confirmed, when you come before Congress to seek funds, you've got to be prepared to answer some tough questions. I particularly am going to continue to be interested in contracting and cost-benefit analyses. I'm going to want to see independent government cost estimates, performance plans, and real metrics. Decisions must be made on facts and data. I expect someone with your experience to be a strong leader, but even the best managed federal agency has waste, fraud, and abuse. I believe that whistleblowers are essential to good government, and I have made it one of my missions to expand and enhance protections for them. I want to make sure that you understand the open lines of communication, responsiveness to employee concerns, and a swift response to retaliation are things I expect from agency leadership. I also encourage any whistleblowers to contact my office if they have information to report. I believe you will also take seriously the role of congressional oversight in your new role. I am glad that you have already agreed to work with me as ranking member of this committee, because we have a lot of work to do. If you are confirmed, I will look forward to building a strong working relationship with you. Our country is facing a difficult time, and we have difficult problems to solve. The Department of Homeland Security needs good management and strong leadership. In your responses to the questionnaire and in our meeting before this hearing, you said that one of your greatest strengths as a leader is speaking truth to power. General Kelly, I can't tell you how that was music to my ears. I believe very much in that principle, and I think that we all anticipate that you will need it in your next job. Well, you will have the responsibility and obligation to speak truth to the Commander-in-Chief, who has used some of his most extreme and divisive rhetoric about issues under the Department of Homeland Security's jurisdiction. Given your experience, I expect you to be up to that challenge. And I think if you're backing down, you'll probably hear from me. I thank you for being here today, and I look forward to your testimony.
Thank you, Senator McCaskill. We have three distinguished individuals making introductions for General Kelly. We'll start with Senator McCain, who needs no introduction. Senator McCain.
But he enjoys it.
Didn't have anything written up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking Member McCaskill, members of the committee, it's an honor to say a few words in support of General John Kelly's nomination to be the next Secretary of Homeland Security. He's an excellent choice, superbly well qualified for the position, and a person of the highest integrity. The American people are fortunate that a man of his caliber is again willing to serve them in an important office after having already devoted many decades of his life to the distinguished service of our country. When he retired from his last command, commander of the U.S. Southern Command, General Kelly was the longest-serving Marine Corps general still on active duty, having worn the uniform for almost a half a century. He was the longest-serving active duty general in Marine Corps history. I think he was the second longest-serving general officer in the entire armed forces, only the late General John Vesey, also an officer of the highest integrity and selfless devotion to duty, served longer, 46 years to General Kelly's 45. When he was nearing the end of his tour as Southcom commander and approaching retirement, he said in an interview that, quote, his greatest fear was that I'd be offered another job. Mr. Chairman, I have no doubt whatsoever that General Kelly's statement was entirely sincere. Those of us who have had the privilege of knowing General Kelly for a while, who have heard him testify before our committees and paid attention to his answers to our questions, know that John Kelly says what he believes to be the truth, always, no matter the inconvenience it might cause him. Speaking truth to power is something he's renowned for, and no less for his respect for the chain of command. Secretary Gates, who is here, one of our great leaders, will mention his relationship with him when they serve together. If anyone has earned a peaceful retirement from public duty, it's General Kelly, but he's a patriot always. And like Jack Vesey, his peer in length of active duty service, he doesn't refuse his country's call. President Reagan called General Vesey out of retirement to serve as his special emissary to Vietnam to get an accounting for America's missing from the war. President-elect Trump has asked General Kelly to lead the Department of Homeland Security and help keep the American people safe from those who wish us harm. It's work he's obviously well qualified for. He served three tours of duty in Iraq, was a key figure in helping sustain the Anbar awakening that, with the surge, turned around a war that we were near to losing. In that role, he learned the value of developing local relationships based on mutual respect, a lesson that served him well in future commands. As Southcom commander, General Kelly was highly regarded for the skill and success he had developing close working relationships with the civilian and military leaders of Latin America and the Caribbean. Many of those leaders consider him a friend. They all respect him. Even more important for his pending assignment, General Kelly has extensive experience with many of the challenges that await him as Homeland Security Secretary. The threats to our security posed by drugs and violence, that make their way into our country across our southern border, and the potential for developing strains of Islamic extremism in the hemisphere to foment terrorist attacks here. He's the right man to meet these and the many other challenges awaiting him. General Kelly isn't, I'm sorry to say, a graduate of the United States Naval Academy. It might surprise the committee that I don't find that lack of credential disqualifying. I barely graduated from the place myself. But he has more impressive credentials. He enlisted in the United States Marine Corps. General Kelly came from modest beginnings, as do most enlisted men and women in our armed services. He's the proud son of his working-class family in the great city of Boston. In conversations with me, he's recalled the childhood friends he's lost to the scourge of drug abuse. Before he went to college, he volunteered to risk his life and limb in an infantry company of the 2nd Marine Division. He was a sergeant when he left the Corps and a second lieutenant when he returned to it 4 years later. What followed was an exemplary career with many challenging assignments and quite a few very dangerous ones, to which he gave every measure of his talent, discipline, courage, and love of country. General Kelly has sacrificed a great deal for his country, more than most. And in every day of his service, he knew and respected and remains in awe of the courage and dedication of the men and women, enlisted and officers, who stand in harm's way so that the rest of us can pursue our aspirations and live our peaceful lives without fear of the terrors they face for our sake. Should he be confirmed as he deserves to be, I'm confident he will be. He will be entitled to the appellation, quote, the Honorable. Few cabinet secretaries will have deserved it more. I endorse his nomination wholeheartedly, with gratitude for his willingness to serve and for the honor of introducing him to you today.
Thanks, Senator McCain. We're going to move the microphone there. Our next distinguished guest offering an introduction will be Senator Carper, who also needs an introduction.
Thank you much, sir.
Oh, that works.
Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to yield to Secretary Gates. In fact, I'd like to do that, if you don't mind. Thank you for the courtesy.
Okay. Our next guest, then, is Secretary Robert Gates. Secretary Gates is the former Secretary of Defense and former Director of Central Intelligence. Secretary Gates led the Department of Defense from 2006 to 2011. Prior to this, Secretary Gates served as the president of Texas A&M University from 2002 to 2006. Secretary Gates began his career as an officer in the United States Air Force and joined the Central Intelligence Agency in 1966. He served 26 years at the CIA and is the only career CIA officer to rise from an entry-level employee to director, the position he held from 1991 to 1993. Secretary Gates has earned numerous honors and distinctions during his career, including the National Security Medal, the Presidential Citizens Medal, the National Intelligence Distinguished Service Medal twice, and the Distinguished Intelligence Medal, which is the CIA's highest award, three times. Welcome, Secretary Gates. It is an honor to have you here today to introduce General Kelly. Secretary Gates.
Thank you, Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member McCaskill, distinguished members of the Committee on Homeland Security and Government Affairs. It gives me great pleasure to introduce my friend and former colleague, John F. Kelly, as the President's nominee to be the next Secretary of Homeland Security. In today's world, the Department of Homeland Security is much like a combat command, perhaps the most complex such command defending our nation and our people. Among its diverse responsibilities are protecting us from terrorism, guarding our borders and coasts, deciding who gets into the country, protecting our transportation networks and infrastructure, defense against cyber attacks, and providing help when disaster strikes. I can think of no one more qualified, more familiar with these threats and challenges, or better prepared to lead our homeland defense than John Kelly. The Department of Homeland Security, as this committee well knows, is a complicated mix of multiple agencies and organizations with different cultures and histories. Yet as Commander of Southern Command, General Kelly successfully managed relationships and partnerships with 7 different cabinet departments, and in all, more than 20 civilian organizations. Leading a combatant command these days requires managing multiple domestic and foreign relationships, and General Kelly did so with great skill and success. I'm confident he would do so as well as Secretary of Homeland Security. In addition, as senior military assistant to two secretaries of defense, John successfully helped lead the largest and most complex organization in the country. He was invaluable to me and to Leon Panetta in helping break down bureaucratic barriers to cooperation and in holding senior officials accountable for decisions and for performance. And the needs of the troops on the front lines were always foremost for him. Of special importance to this committee, John Kelly was twice assigned as Marine Corps liaison to the Congress, the second time as the Commandant's senior legislative assistant. As a result, he has a deep understanding of the legislative process and especially of the need to be responsive to Congress and to have a relationship of openness and trust. In terms of skills and experience, General Kelly is, in my view, superbly qualified to serve as Secretary. But it is John's character and values that truly set him apart. To put it quite simply, he is one of the finest people I have ever known. I would trust him with my life, and indeed many others, mainly young Marines, literally have done so. And how often is it that a tough commander genuinely is beloved by his troops? Integrity in word and deed is the source of moral authority, and it is moral authority that moves people to follow a leader even at personal risk and sacrifice. John Kelly is a man of great moral authority. If he is confirmed, the professionals throughout the Department of Homeland Security will realize that their new secretary cares about each and every one of them, and that he will do everything in his power to protect and support them and to get them what they need to do their jobs, protecting all of us. I commend the President-elect for nominating General Kelly for this position because, as I know firsthand, John is a straight-talking, candid, courageous leader who will say exactly what he thinks. His values are a reflection of America's best values, and he will not disappoint. Over a military career spanning more than 40 years, John Kelly and his family have sacrificed much serving our country. And yet, here he is, willing to serve again. It is with great pride that I introduce him to you today. Thank you.
Thanks, Secretary Gates. Senator Carper.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you. I want to thank and congratulate our new ranking member, Claire McCaskill, and see all of my colleagues from this point of view. It's good to see you all up there. It's a privilege to join Senator McCain, with whom I served during the Vietnam War. And I would just say from my vantage point, John, you're a hero. And I'm proud to have served with you and proud to know you today and to sit with you today. Secretary Gates, you're one of the finest Secretary of Defense we've ever had. And I am honored to be with you today as well. We're introducing a man, as you know, who needs a little introduction to this committee. General John Kelly, John Francis Kelly. And to welcome his wife, Karen, and their daughter, Kathleen, and her husband, Jake, sitting behind us to this confirmation hearing. Karen, I said to your husband yesterday, given all the years that he served and you've allowed him to serve, for you, no purgatory, straight to heaven. And so thank you for continuing to share with us an extraordinary man. Created about a dozen or so years ago, the Department of Homeland Security's 240,000 employees get up every day. They go to work. They go to work to protect our homeland and all of us who are privileged to live here. Almost every month for the past 4 years, I've gone to the Senate floor, as some of my colleagues know, to talk about the remarkable work that they do for all of us. They respond to devastating hurricanes, saving lives, and helping people put their lives back together. They protect us from cyber attacks and help secure thousands of miles of our country's borders to the north and to the south, to the east and to the west. They expedite the movement of billions of dollars of commerce every day, while intercepting drugs and disrupting human smuggling trafficking rings. They keep us safe when we fly the sometimes not so friendly skies of this country and this world. They protect presidents and vice presidents and their families, as well as candidates for these offices, and the leaders of scores of other nations who come here. They do all of this and a whole lot more, oftentimes without a word of thanks. General John Kelly is an exceptionally well-qualified nominee to lead the Department of Homeland Security, as you've heard. If confirmed, he would succeed another exceptional leader, Secretary Jay Johnson. Jay Johnson, who with the help of his leadership team, this committee and Congress, has begun, a remarkable transformation of the department that was badly needed and is much welcome. I found over my lifetime that the key to success of any organization, whether it's military, government, business, or whatever, the success of any organization I've ever been a part of or witnessed is almost always enlightened leadership. John Kelly is a leader. He is humble, not haughty. He has the heart of a servant. He understands that his job has been and will be to serve, not be served. He leads by example. With General John Kelly, it's not do as I say, but do as I do. He has the courage to stay out of step when everyone else is marching to the wrong tune. He surrounds himself with the best people he can find, and when his team does well, he gives them the credit. And when the team falls short, he takes the blame. He doesn't believe in raising himself up by pushing other people down. He is a purveyor of hope and consistently appeals to people's better angels. Throughout John Kelly's 45 years of military service in the Marine Corps, he has sought to do what is right, not what is easy or expedient. He embraces the golden rule, treating other people that he would want the way he'd want to be treated. He looks at adversity and sees opportunity. He believes that in everything we do, we can do better. He's tenacious. There is no quit in this man. And when he knows he's right, he doesn't give up. When we met in my office yesterday, General Kelly spoke of the importance of addressing the root causes of some of the problems and challenges that we face as a nation, not just the symptoms of those problems. As an example, he cited the transformation of Colombia from an almost failed nation 20 years ago to a far different one today and a valued ally and trading partner of ours. He also spoke of our addiction to drugs and how that's the root cause of much of the violence and lawlessness in countries like Honduras and Guatemala and Salvador. And while he spoke thoughtfully and creatively of ways to better secure our southern border with Mexico, for example, he understands that those steps need to be coupled with others embodied in the Alliance for Prosperity adopted by Honduras, Guatemala, and Salvador, supported by the U.S., much as we've supported Plan Colombia for 2 decades. And finally, General Kelly understands the importance of working cooperatively with the Congress. And Secretary Gates has given us a couple of explanations of why that might be the case with two of your tours here on Capitol Hill. But I think you understand the importance of working, especially with this committee. And General Kelly may not always tell us what we want to hear in this room or outside of it, but he will always tell us what we need to hear. And when it's needed, he'll remind the people he leads at the Department of Homeland Security to, quote, just use some common sense, the way my dad used to remind my sister and me when we were young. In short, he'll provide the leadership that will enable the Department of Homeland Security to continue the transformation it's begun. In doing so, he'll make us safer as a nation, even as he makes us prouder as a country of the team that I hope he'll be confirmed to lead. Thank you for your willingness to do this and for my colleagues for welcoming him and giving me this opportunity to speak truth to power.
Thank you. Thanks, Senator Carper. General Kelly, it is the tradition of this committee to swear in witnesses, so if you'll please stand and raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony you will give before this committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Please be seated. General Kelly.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member McCaskill, distinguished senators of the committee, please accept my thanks, my deep appreciation for considering my nomination to lead the men and women of the United States Department of Homeland Security. Senators McCain, Carper, Secretary Gates, thank you for taking the time to be here on my behalf and for your very, very kind words. My wife and family have already been introduced, but I'll say it again. My wife, Karen, is with me here today. She's my hero. She's put up with more in our 40 years of marriage than you could ever imagine. And my daughter, Kathleen, is here as well. And her recent husband, Jake, Lance Corporal, United States Marine Corps retired, Jake Fox, another American hero. I thank them for their service and for their sacrifice. Over the past 45 years, I've been privileged to serve my country as both an enlisted Marine as an officer. I've led platoons through divisions in corps, held senior command positions in Iraq, served as the combatant commander of the United States Southern Command, and as Secretary Gates mentioned, as a senior military assistant to two of my heroes, Secretaries Gates and Panetta. I've worked across the interagency. I've worked with our allies, the private sector, and independent experts to identify innovative and comprehensive solutions to current and emerging threats. These assignments, while varied, shared the common characteristics of working within and leading large, complex, and very diverse multi-missioned organizations, while under great pressure to produce results. I'm humbled once again to be called to serve, this time with the wonderful men and women of the Department of Homeland Security. As a nation, we are reminded almost daily that the threats to our homeland have not receded in any way. The challenges to our way of life have not diminished. As I solemnly swore before my God when I entered the Marine Corps, if confirmed, I will faithfully support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, every second of every day. I believe in America and the principles upon which our country and way of life are guaranteed. I believe in respect, tolerance, and diversity of opinion. I have a profound respect for the law and will always strive to uphold it. I've never had a problem speaking truth to power, and I firmly believe that those in power deserve full candor and my honest assessment and recommendations. I also value people that work for me speaking truth to power. I love my country, and I will do everything within my power to preserve our liberty, enforce our laws, and protect our citizens. I recognize the many challenges facing the department, and should I be confirmed, I look forward to partnering with you to protect the homeland. Sir, I look forward to discussing the future of the department and answering the committee's questions. Thanks so very much.
Thank you, General Kelly. Again, I want to remind the members I'm going to limit questions to 7 minutes, and I'm going to be very disciplined in maintaining the 7 minutes. There are questions that I will ask, and then I'll reserve the rest of my time and defer to Senator McCain or Chairman McCain, who I know is limited time. But let me start with the three questions. General Kelly, is there anything you are aware of in your background that might present a conflict of interest with the duties of the office to which you have been nominated?
There's nothing, sir.
Do you know of anything, personal or otherwise, that would in any way prevent you from fully and honorably discharging the responsibilities of the office to which you have been nominated?
There is nothing, Senator.
Do you agree without reservation to comply with any request or summons to appear and testify before any duly constituted committee of Congress if you are confirmed?
I do.
Thank you. Senator McCain.
General, as you know, we passed legislation on the defense bill prohibiting torture, including waterboarding. Do you intend to follow that law?
Absolutely, Senator.
And what is your personal view of waterboarding and other forms of torture?
Senator, I don't think we should ever come close to crossing a line that is beyond what we as Americans would expect to follow in terms of interrogation techniques.
Would that be basically the Geneva Conventions?
Absolutely, yes, sir.
Thank you. You know, there's a epidemic in this country, and it's opioids, and it's coming from Mexico, manufactured in Mexico, and regrettably, according to information that I have, a lot of it is coming across the Arizona-Mexico border into Phoenix, Arizona, and being distributed nationwide. And as you well know, we are experiencing a dramatic increase in deaths from overdoses. And that is taking place amongst many older Americans that have turned from OxyContin and other substances. In fact, former Governor of New Hampshire will testify here, I think, of the really severe aspects of this, what many have called an epidemic. I'm very interested in your views and taking into fundamental economics, that if there's a demand, there's going to be a supply. But what is your view of that situation, General?
Senator, I think I'd start off by saying it's amazing to me, but I just found out very recently that an old friend who's not so old, 62 years old, just after a very successful life, just overdosed on heroin. And I think to your point, it's cheaper, more available in many ways than some of the opioids, and she could not apparently get a prescription for what she thought she needed. But the point is that most Americans don't realize it, but an awful lot, 100% of the heroin that we consume in the United States is in fact produced in Mexico, and it's creeping down now into Central America. They have responded, the cartels, the networks, have responded to the demand. So instead of Asia and South Asia, it now is all produced here in the Western Hemisphere. Poppies are grown in countries as far south now as Guatemala, a little bit in Colombia, although they're getting after it. But it is all produced here. An awful lot of the opioids, what looks like pharmaceuticals, are actually produced, again, in Mexico, and then pirated up here through the border. And, of course, part of the problem, I think, and this is, I think, would be outside my particular area if confirmed, but part of the problem is we are a very overly medicated society. Huge amounts of opioids are prescribed legally for things that in the past would probably not receive that level of medication. So the point is, huge problem, getting worse, and the profits are just unbelievable to the cartels that control the whole marketing and transport.
There's been a great deal of conversation about building a wall. And it's been my experience that we need to have barriers, but building a wall is not the way to prevent the flow of drugs or people illegally across our border. I think it requires ranging from drones to towers to use of some of the technological advantages that we have. If you just very briefly tell us what you think is necessary to have a secure border.
Yes, Senator. A physical barrier in of itself, certainly as a military person that understands defense and defenses, physical barrier in and of itself will not do the job. It has to be really a layered defense. If you were to build a wall from the Pacific to the Gulf of Mexico, you'd still have to back that wall up with patrolling by human beings, by sensors, by observation devices. But as I've said to many of the senators present, and I've said, I think, for 3 years, really, I believe the defense of the southwest border really starts about 1,500 miles south, and that is partnering with some great countries as far south as Peru, really, that are very cooperative with us in terms of getting after the drug production, transport, good with us, to include Mexico. We could have better partnerships. I think we can work closer with them. We can give them more of what they need. We certainly share intel with them now, information with them now. We have legal attachés in many of our embassies, and they developed unbelievable amounts of...
I don't mean to interrupt, but isn't it technology that would help us secure the border as much as anything else? I'm talking about surveillance. I'm talking about capabilities to intercept, but not to just sit there. In other words, the kind of border security that we see in Israel.
Technology would be a big part of it, yes, Senator.
And that technology would be, would that be drones? Would
observation
it be
devices?
Towers?
Would it be? The aerostats, observation devices mounted in you know, certain terrain features, UAVs for sure, sensors in places perhaps that the wall can't be built or won't be built in any time soon in terms of the immensity of that project. But yes, sir.
Finally, the morale of our Border Patrol is not real good. And I think you know from your leadership experiences that if the morale of your force is not good, then it's hard to get the mission accomplished. And I know you're aware of that, and I hope you'll spend some time with these really outstanding men and women who are doing arduous work, sometimes under very, very difficult conditions. It gets very hot on the Sonora-Arizona border, as you know. So there is morale problems there. A lot of it has to do with they think they're not given the capabilities to do their job as they think they can do it most efficiently. And I know you'll be focusing a lot of attention on that.
I will, Senator.
Senator McCaskill.
General Kelly, on Friday, the Office of Director of National Intelligence released a declassified report on the assessment of Russian activities and intentions in our recent election. I'm going to quote from the report for the record. Russian efforts to influence the 2016 U.S. presidential election represent the most recent expression of Moscow's longstanding desire to undermine the U.S.-led liberal democratic order. But these activities demonstrate a significant escalation in directness, level of activity, and scope of effort compared to previous operations. We assess Russian President Vladimir Putin ordered an influence campaign in 2016 aimed at the U.S. presidential election. Russia's goals were to undermine public faith in the U.S. democratic process, denigrate Secretary Clinton, and harm her electability and potential presidency. We further assess Putin and the Russian government developed a clear preference for President-elect Trump. We have high confidence in these judgments. General Kelly, do you accept the conclusions of the intelligence community regarding Russian interference in our election?
With high confidence.
On border security, I think that Senator McCain covered a lot of this. I want to point out that the budget we now have annually on border security equals the combined budgets of FBI, ATF, DEA, Secret Service, U.S. Marshals, plus the entire New York Police Department budget. It's $19 billion in fiscal year 2016. And in fiscal year 2016, we had 331,000 people apprehended at the border. Almost 50% of those turned themselves in. In other words, all the border security agents in the world, all the fences in the world wouldn't have made any difference because they said, hey, take us. We're here. We want asylum. So I guess my question to you is, do you have it on your agenda to examine the spending priorities of that $19 billion and look at the efficacy of every place we're spending that money? And most importantly, how will you address the fact that almost half of the people coming to the border right now that we're apprehending are not trying to evade detection? They're just trying to find someplace safe.
On the first question, Senator, any time I've ever taken over a new organization, certainly I go top to bottom and look real hard at how we're doing business. Clearly, people that would have come before me, if I'm confirmed, many all did a great job, Secretary Johnson and others. But my typical approach is to do a top to bottom assessment, and I certainly will do that. On the asylum issue, I'm confident that most of the people that are coming up here from certainly Central America are coming here for two reasons. One, or three probably. One, the first is it is very unsafe. They're some of the most dangerous countries on the planet, and that's unfortunate. Not only because of that, but a lot of social issues or lack of economic development. And then finally, they're very confident if they pay the money, get on the network, they will get to the United States, and they will be, in their view at least, unlikely that they'll be going back to Honduras, Guatemala, other countries like that.
I'll look forward to your assessment, and I know we talked in my office about the drug cartels and what big role they have in the people showing up seeking asylum, because most of the violence is attributable to that, as opposed to DACA or any other pronouncements or policies of the Obama administration. The last thing I want to mention to you is the enhancements on electronic system for travel authorization. I think people don't realize, I'm aware of a situation recently where because of the electronic enhancements, we were able to stop someone from coming to America that was coming from a visa waiver country to South America and then was planning on coming to America and doing us harm, and we were able to stop that travel. In fact, since February of 2016, 40,000 individuals have been denied visa-free travel due to the enhancements that have been put in place. Along with that is we've tried to do pre-clearance in various countries around the world so that we are checking people before they get on the plane with maybe somebody would call it extreme vetting. Mm-hmm. That is now going on across the globe. Have you had a chance to look at that? And do you believe that, I mean, because that's really the border that I'm most worried about in terms of our safety. Right. Are people traveling here from visa waiver countries with an eye towards doing our country harm and our ability to stop them?
Senator, I think that the visa waiver countries clearly are countries that have at least law enforcement and information systems in place that we have confidence in. Nothing's perfect. Many other countries, as you know, don't have nearly that kind of system in place, and consequently we wouldn't have the confidence there. But nothing's perfect. Many countries, again, a high degree of confidence that their citizens that come here will not cause problems. But, you know, ever vigilant. And in those countries that don't have the systems in place, I think we somehow have to convince ourselves that everyone coming here, we have a reasonable expectation that they won't do us harm, whether it's crime or terrorism or...
Some of the enhancements that have been put in place are you a member of Global Entry Program? Have you traveled to or been present in Iraq, Syria, Iran, Sudan, Yemen, Somalia, or Libya on or after March 1st, 2011? Other questions that are part of this. Do you believe it's important that we expand this program, the enhancements and the preclearance program?
I think it's a good idea. I don't know exactly the details of it, but it would appear to me that it's a good idea. But again, we have to have confidence in the information that we're getting on site to prevent people that would come here to do us harm.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And Senator McCaskill, I notice our next new member is showing up. So, Senator Hovind, welcome to the committee. Appreciate. Now, I gave up my questioning slot to Senator, to Chairman McCain. I know Chairman Enzi also is managing some activity on the floor, so I'll defer to Chairman Enzi, and then we'll get back on schedule.
I thank the chairman. I do need to go back to the floor, and I do appreciate the chance that I had to meet with General Kelly. In my early days here in the Senate, there was a change in the makeup of the majority, and we became the minority, and it created a little problem of a vacancy in the Foreign Relations Committee, and I happened to get that Foreign Relations Committee spot, and they had to redo all the committees, and there was one committee that apparently nobody wanted because I became the ranking member on it. Now, that was just shortly before 9/11. So right after that, I had a lot of people saying, so how did the new guy get the Anti-Terrorism Committee? I was even on a United Nations committee that was supposed to find the bad guys. And I guess it was fortunate or maybe unfortunate that just about all of us were accountants. So what we did was follow the money. Mm-hmm. And we got 130 countries involved in it. And several of them found the bad guys and prosecuted the bad guys and in some cases executed the bad guys. And it was effective until they figured out what we were doing. You're going to have a huge role in the anti-terrorism area. I think we spend $46 billion on your budget. And we've got to be sure we're finding the bad guys. And I'd be interested in any approaches that you'd be doing to effectively spend that money and develop policy that will help us.
To the degree that I'm familiar with what's going on already, I think any time that we can work with partners overseas, and again, we have representatives, we mean the United States, law enforcement, agency people, intel people, and most of the most important countries in this regard around the world in our embassies, and they really do have pretty good they have very, very good relationships generally speaking with the local law enforcement, local intel people. I think anything we can do to get into that level of information. I know in Southern Command, as an example, most of the intel, the most usable intel I used tended to come from the CIA, not CIA, FBI and the DEA folk representatives in our embassies. But anything we can do to, you know, kind of enhance the information sharing within the law, of course, between other countries and ourselves, and certainly within our own interagency. You know, we've gotten much better at it since 9/11 in terms of information sharing. One of the things I definitely will get into, if confirmed, is to find out how well that's going domestically, because we have the department has some responsibilities in terms of information sharing. We have an awful lot of great systems in place. I'm not sure, because I don't know if they're all talking to each other and sharing in the way that they should be.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because one of my pet peeves has been that for people coming into the country legally, that we check them in on a series of computers and we check them out on a series of computers, but I'm not sure that we ever got the computers connected so that we could know who was here and who wasn't here. I think the most effective enforcement is if we find them as soon as their visa runs out. So I hope that you'd put that on your list of things maybe to do. Recently, I was flying back to Wyoming, and the person sitting next to me was a member of the Border Patrol. And he didn't know that I was a senator, but I was very curious about how things were going. He'd just been to a training session, and he'd been doing it for quite a while. And he was pretty depressed. I would say he had low morale. Told me that they could do a lot of things, but because there's rampant lawbreaking along the border, and he felt that orders from Washington kind of tied his hands, that they couldn't respond effectively. As a commander, I know you relied on your officers and your troops, and you developed plans and you executed missions and in some very difficult situations for keeping the morale of the people who were under you going. Have you developed any plans for how you're going to check on the Border Patrol and see if there are some morale things that could be changed?
Sir, I mean, one of the things I've always done, learned from some of the finest leaders, I think, certainly in the U.S. military, you got to get out and about. You got to get out and, figuratively speaking, kick the tires, look around. Interesting you should make that point. I was just prior to my leaving active duty, because I worked so closely with Homeland Security and law enforcement, even though Mexico was not in my area of interest, I took a trip up to El Paso. In uniform, and just went to the port of entry and then met with some officers there, and just to thank them and to tell them from my position in the South, they were doing a great job. Met with some of the Border Patrol folks, same thing. And when you say things like, listen, just how are things going, you know, pull out a tape recorder because you're going to find out. And that's, I think, a very, very important way to find out about things. Encourage people to speak truth to power from the bottom up. And certainly any time a whistleblower calls in and makes an accusation or makes a comment, it's very definitely worth listening. So that's how I do business. Sometimes you get an earful and wish you hadn't asked the question, but you should always ask the question.
I appreciate that. I used to be in small business, and sitting in an office didn't solve all the problems. You had to get out and see what was happening. Sure. Thank you for your answers, and my time's about to expire. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Enzi. Senator Carper.
Thanks. Thanks so much. A quick one. We talked a little bit about this when you visited with me in my office this week. But there's a unit within the Department of Homeland Security that goes by an acronym. And the acronym is NPPD. And we talked about people say, well, what is that? Or what does that represent? There's a lot of confusion, not much understanding. As it turns out, it refers to cybersecurity. Right. And refers to infrastructure protection. And it's an agency that's supposed to do both of those. But just by hearing the name, you'd never know. Any thoughts on that?
Well, when I looked at the org chart, maybe one of the first questions I had was, what does that block do? So I agree. I mean, I think it's a name change, not always important. It might be in this case. It's been brought up to me, Senator, a number of times. You did, obviously, but other people within the organization, and not within Homeland Security. I've not spoken to anyone in Homeland Security right now because of the MOU. But people have brought it up to me, past members of Homeland Security. So as we talked in your office, sir, we'll take a look at that up front.
Thanks so much. When I was stationed in the Navy, stationed for a while in San Diego and would venture down into Mexico, and there was a time when people went back and forth between Southern California and Mexico rather easily. And there was a time when there's a huge amount of illegal immigration from Mexico into the U.S. I'm told that today there are more Mexicans going back into Mexico than there are Mexicans coming into the United States. And why do you suppose that is? And are there any lessons from that development that might be applicable for the immigration of people, large immigration for people from Honduras, Guatemala, and Salvador?
It's a great question. I have a great deal of experience in Central America, and I hold the people to our south in a very, very high regard. And I understand, I think, and empathize with their problem. They, for the most part, don't want to come up and leave their homes, their families. But there isn't an awful lot of economic opportunity for them there. And there's certainly a level of violence that in our country we couldn't imagine. Honduras, as an example, when I took over in Southern Command, was the most violent planet by UN numbers, most violent country on the planet, 91 deaths per 100,000. By contrast, our country's about 5. Through a lot of good work down there, not always perfect, but the president has taken that down by a third. Still horrific levels of violence. But my point is they don't, most of the time, don't come here for any other purpose than to have some economic opportunity and to and escape violence. My view, and I've stated this for 3 years when I was at Southern Command, certainly when I testified before this committee in April, my view is if we can help them if we can help them by reducing our drug demand, which is the fundamental problem of many of their problems, by reducing our drug demand, by the same time, at the same time helping them improve their police, their militaries are actually pretty good. Human rights is and, you know, very much part of the way they operate. And if we improve the situation of violence, then my belief is investment would come, and so there'd be economic opportunity there. The three countries in the northern tier, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras, have banded together and developed their own approach called the the name escapes me, but
Alliance for Prosperity
that we help them develop. And so they're putting their own money against it, and they really seek foreign investment, not money from the United States, but investment maybe from the United States. So I think if we were to do that for them, there'd be a lot. And frankly, they will tell you, as long as the migrants leave Honduras or wherever and generally speaking get into the United States easily, safely, and don't come back, there's going to be a draw. So we have to get our arms, I think, around those three factors.
When we were together the other day, we talked about Colombia and how 20 years ago a bunch of gunmen rounded up the Supreme Court of Colombia. They took them into a room and shot them all to death. And today, Colombia is not a perfect nation, but it's a much different nation. And a strong partner of ours, strong trading partner of ours, and a fairly vibrant democracy. None of us are perfect. But I like to say in Plan Colombia, which was worked by a number of people who worked on that, certainly President Clinton, Joe Biden was in, I think, the chairman and me of the Foreign Relations Committee. But I described Plan Colombia and also the Alliance for Prosperity, which is developed by Honduras, Guatemala, and Salvador, as I call it the Home Depot plan. And, you know, Home Depot and their advertising, they say, you can do it, we can help. In this case, Colombia, you can do it, we can help, and we have. Honduras, Guatemala, and Salvador, you can do it. And in this case, we're permitted to do that. We've committed so far 1 year of funding. And the President Obama has asked, Vice President Biden has asked for a second tranche. Do you have any thoughts along those lines?
You know, Senator, anytime someone tells me, and a lot of people tell me, have told me, I reference back to my time in Southern Command, that tells me that the Central American republics cannot be helped. You know, parts of Mexico cannot be helped. I said, look at Colombia. Colombians were in the exact same place 20 years ago, looking into the abyss. They made some fundamental changes to the way they, how they did business, how they allowed their military to operate. And they are today exporters of what we called when I was in South America, exporters of security. And by that I mean they go out and help other countries in the region, particularly in the Central American Isthmus, help them help themselves. They're our best friends, in my view, in Latin America, and they are already stepping up to help and would like to do more. You know, the Alliance for Prosperity, when we were helping them, my original thinking was, well, let's call this Plan Central America, like Plan Colombia. And Plan Colombia really came out of this institution, out of the Congress, and then the Clinton administration picked up on it. And it worked. 4 cents on the dollar, U.S. money. All the rest of it was paid for by the Colombians. But back to the Plan Central America, there were people in the interagency that didn't think that we should do that, so we went up with the Alliance for Prosperity. You know, it rose by any other name. It's kind of the same thing.
All right, thanks so much.
Thanks, Senator Carper. Senator Portman, just for other senators, it's going to be Portman, Tester, Daines, Peters, Harris, Paul, Hassan, Langford. I believe it's Heidkamp and Hoven, but we'll figure out. And then that's the order. Senator Portman.
Hello. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Kelly, first let me echo the comments of others to thank you for your remarkable 4.5 decades of service to our country and the sacrifices your family has made. I'm particularly appreciative of your wife, Karen, who apparently told you that you had to answer the call once again. And we've seen with your introductions today that you're likely to be confirmed, and I'm just delighted you're willing to serve. I do have three areas of inquiry I'd like to touch on, and we talked about some of this in our meeting. The first is your management challenge. You said you've been a member of some large, complex organizations. This will be the most complex and the largest, and it's 240,000 employees. When you look at it, there are probably, you know, 20 major offices or departments within it. And as you know, I was part of the select committee in the House to put this together after 9/11, knowing that the left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing. We had to protect the country. But frankly, I've been frustrated by the lack of progress, and having a department work is one. And it's been mentioned the morale problems, but there's a lack of coordination in many people's eyes, some inefficiencies. So the first question I would ask you really is a management question. What are the three things that you would intend to do to help make the department work more effectively to protect us?
First thing, I mean, I'm sure you are aware, I know, that the unity of effort that Secretary Johnson has embarked upon, you know, the taking a look around at the other bureaucracies, and I don't mean that in a negative way at all, the way that other departments work. I know the Senate is very aware of the fact that the Department of Defense is a better place today than it was 30 years ago before Goldwater Nichols, and people of my rank, that wasn't my fault at the time, but people of my rank fought tooth and nail against the Congress for 30 years. Ultimately, laws were passed, Goldwater Nichols, and we have become a better place because we've knocked down a lot of the rice bowls, got people talking to each other. Yes, you know, the Marines still are the best, but the other services are pretty good, too. But, you know, we all have our traditions and ways of thinking and doing business, and we didn't have to give that up when we went to a jointness. I think there's a place for that. And I know that Secretary Johnson has already done that. I'm going to get smart about that as fast as I can. I think as much as we can draw, I mean, the mission is Homeland Security. That's a mission I believe everyone can get behind. Just like DOD, the mission is to defend the nation abroad primarily. I don't know if there's been enough of that, but I believe even though there's very separate groups within Homeland Security, if everyone can understand first and foremost we protect the nation and then we do that in different ways, much like DOD, I think it would go a long way to bringing the department together, much as Secretary Johnson has begun. And then there's just other things. I mean, some of the senators and others have recommended to be some organizational changes, personnel changes, not individual people, but, you know, why has this person got this many undersecretaries or assistants? I take a look at all of that. To Senator McCaskill's point, there's probably efficiencies there and there's savings there, and I commit to the committee for sure.
We would appreciate that. And a top-to-bottom review, I think, is always a good idea, as you said, when you come into a new place, but particularly with an agency as complex as this one. One subset let me ask you about is intelligence. I'm also concerned about redundancies in our intelligence community. There's 17 intelligence agencies in the government, if you count them all. Two of them reside at Department of Homeland Security. One is Coast Guard Intelligence. But the other is this Office of Intelligence and Analysis. And, frankly, again, I have not been as impressed as I hoped I would be with their mission, which is really to fuse intelligence from all the different sources together to be able to better protect the country, and including a private sector, a liaison to help with infrastructure. They're supposed to track terrorists and their networks, assess risks, and so on. What's your sense of that entity, and do you think it could be improved?
I think everything can be improved. And what I've learned, and once again, Senator, I've been restricted from actually dealing with Homeland Security. But what I get from the transition team and others that have worked at Homeland Security is that that could be better, the information sharing within the organization and even out to law enforcement. Mm-hmm. But again, it's way up on the list in terms of things I'll look at.
How about fusion centers? In all of our states, we have fusion centers now. Are they effective? Are they redundant? Should they be wound down? Should they be reinforced? What's your sense of how the fusion centers are working?
Depending on who has talked to me about them, they're effective and they're redundant. Mm-hmm.
And I think, frankly, even within our states, we might find that some are more effective than others. I would hope you would also, in your top-to-bottom review, take a look at those fusion centers and be sure they're doing the job they should be doing. My sense is they were also supposed to compile information and intelligence, is sometimes because classified intelligence is difficult to compile if you're not within the deeper in the community. Sometimes right. It's being done by other entities, and there's not information being provided to some of our first responders. But I would love to have your assessment of that once you've had a chance to be on the ground. The final question I have is about the drug issue. And as you heard earlier, this is an epidemic. You and I have talked about it. I loved your testimony before the committee last year. I talked to you about that, and I've complimented you in the committee since then on that, because you focused on the demand side. And I'm a strong believer that until we deal with prevention and education better and treatment and recovery, it's going to be very difficult to stop this flow of drugs. They will find other ways to do it. On the other hand, almost unimpeded now across the southern border. As you say, almost all the heroin is produced, it's consumed here in Mexico, as well as many of the drugs. So two questions. One, what would you do to increase that apprehension? You mentioned interdiction earlier and pushing back beyond the border. And second, we have legislation called the STOP Act, which is intended to deal with this issue of fentanyl and carfentanil, which is a synthetic heroin, really the next wave we're seeing in our communities. That mostly comes by mail, and some of it actually from Mexico, also comes from China directly, then sometimes mixed with heroin in Mexico and brought back in a drug form. But it's not taken by packages across the border physically. It goes through the U.S. mail system. We've tried to work with Customs and Border Protection on this, as well as DEA, and I just wonder if you had any sense of that issue, what you would do, and just your general thoughts on interdiction.
I believe interdiction starts in cocaine or whatever. It starts really where it's produced. The Colombians, to use that example again, do tremendous work in terms of eradicating coca and destroying labs and that kind of thing. Tremendous work and taking huge tonnages off the flow with very, very few naval assets, and I use Coast Guard there as well. Very, very few naval assets. South Com, and my information's at least a year old, but South Com gets a couple of hundred tons a year. And the beauty of it down there is you get it in 1-ton, 2-ton, 3-ton lots. Once it gets ashore and starts its ride up the network, a big take at the southwest border of, say, cocaine or something like that might be 5, 10, 15 kilos. Mm-hmm. So I think if we could do more with our partners, the problem is, again, not to harp on the demand thing, but if we were to block the network so nothing could get through the southwest border, the so-called balloon effect, they'd find other ways around. The profits are so outrageous. That's why I believe it's all about the demand.
Thank you, General. I appreciate it.
Senator Tester.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking Member McCaskill and General Kelly, thank you for being here and thank you for putting yourself up for this. First things first, though, I want to thank your family for sharing you with us one more time. I very much appreciate your guys' commitment to this because it's oftentimes not easy, and these jobs are oftentimes not easy, and this is one of those jobs. It's not easy, so thank you. And General Kelly, thank you, as Senator McCaskill said, for getting your ethics report in, your background complete, your pre-questionnaire in, your financials. I appreciate that very much also. Your job is a big one, and I know from our meeting in my office, and I want to thank you for your direct answer of the questions we talked about there and today, too. We talked about border security. We hear a lot about the southern border, which is critically important. Mm-hmm. The northern border with a 540-mile border with Montana alone, with one national park bordering Canada and an Indian reservation bordering Canada and three more. Three Indian reservations within 100 miles of Canada, it adds to the complexity. But I think you've got a grasp of that. I'm going to start out a little parochial, but I'm going to take it to the bigger issue. We talked about a port north of Plentywood that DHS wanted to close, a 24-hour port. It was my belief that this port was critical for border security on the northern border because it was a port with a long distance between the other 224 on the east and the west. What is your view with border security as it applies to not only the folks that are on patrol, but the folks who are in the ports?
Well, sir, I think it's you know, it's clearly a balance. I mean, there's a we can't stop the normal flow of commerce and just legal people. By the same token, we've got to do better at finding or closing the border to the things that we don't want to come in. I'm not as familiar nearly as we discussed mm-hmm. with the issues of the northern border. But as I promised you in your office the other day, I'll be very quick to come up on that and perhaps even during the summer visit your state.
And, I'll take you up on that. And we'll make sure we don't get you into North Dakota because they'd give you the wrong impression. And we'll follow up on that. But there are grants like Stone Garden grants that are critically important. There are efforts to be made with the local farmers and ranchers that live on that border, and I need to get you there. So actually you can talk to those folks because right. I think they're not paid by you or us. But still an important part of the overall structure of Homeland Security. I want to talk about immigration for a second. When you're in my office, you said what I've thought for a long time, and that is that we make folks jump through hoops to get the visa, and then after they come in the country, we'd never tell them to head home. How do you anticipate to make it work when those visas expire to be able to notify those folks that time to head back?
To the degree that I've been in discussions on this point, apparently we don't have a particularly good system to kind of alert when, you know, the day after someone's visa expires. We don't have a very good system to say this person's visa expired and to share that information, whether it's with, within the department for sure and then local law enforcement. And it's not until, as you know, Senator, people get caught doing something wrong, speeding or something like that, that they get caught and we say, okay, this
That's
person.
Right.
So the discussions I've had is that we've got to do better with systems, first of all, alerting us that someone has stayed past, and then, as appropriate, perhaps send someone to their house or their last known residence and ask them why they haven't departed yet. But the other issue, as I've been briefed, and this is kind of hard, but, as you know, when non-citizens come in, we record them. When they go out by air, commercial air, we record them leaving. What we don't do very well at, apparently, is at the ground entrances. So I'll look into that as well.
Well, I appreciate any work you can do on that because I think that would help solve not all, but certainly a fair amount of the problem. Real ID is something that's been of controversy in the state of Montana since my days back in the state legislature, which is over 10 years ago now. For the time being, DHS has waived part of the law requiring construction of a linked nationwide database required by the law. I know Senator Paul's also concerned about this. What are your plans to implement the Real ID issue as it applies to states like Montana that don't really want to see this nationwide database?
Well, as the Senator knows,
and still keep our country safe. Right, right. It's a tough nut.
As the Senator knows, it's in the law. It's my understanding that the Secretary has some elbow room in terms of waiving it. I'd like to think that, and I'm not completely, you know, kind of conversant with it, but I'd like to think that in the small number of states that have not met the the point at which they have safe ID cards, I'd like to, you know, maybe work with this. No, absolutely work with the states to find out way ahead what we can do to come to an agreement. There's always the possibility of additional time waivers, but I'd like to work with the states on that, Senator.
Okay, thank you. In your particular case, this is a big department. It's got a lot of different arms sticking out there, and your deputies are going to be really, really, really important.
Right.
What are you going to be looking for your deputy secretaries?
For anyone that works, I think, for the federal government, but certainly at the senior level, people that are, first of all, they know what they're doing, understand the importance of following the law, and understand the importance of taking care of their people. To Senator McCaskill's point again, people that will listen to their subordinates when there's suggestions of how to do business better, listen to their subordinates when there's more serious problems, and not retaliate against anyone when they come up and raise issues.
Okay. Last question very quickly. What's your highest priority when you're considering anti-terror efforts?
Stopping them somewhere well away from our country.
Very good. Thank you, General.
Sir.
Thank you, Senator Tester. One thing you'll notice, General Kelly, the northern border is very well represented on this committee, sometimes in duplicate. Next is Senator Daines.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Kelly, it was truly an honor to have you in the office yesterday. Thank you for considering coming to Montana. We'll take a look at that northern border. As the chairman just mentioned, I just counted heads here, Mr. Chairman. 8 out of 15 members in this committee actually have a northern border. Just 2 have a southern border. And that's not to say the southern border is not important, but this committee will also not forget about that important northern border. I also want to thank your family. As the son of a Marine, my dad would be very proud if he were here knowing that we're having this conversation. So thank you for your service. My family sleeps better at night knowing that a 4-star general, a Marine, no less, is leading the Department of Homeland Security. So thank you. And thank you very much, Karen, and to the rest of the family for allowing the general to continue to service our country. General Kelly, as we discussed yesterday, I spent 28 years in the private sector before I came to the Hill, 10 years with a global cloud computing company. We face cyber threats daily. The customers expected their data to be secure. We delivered. Our data was never compromised. And then I came to the federal government, became an employee of the federal government, elected to Congress in 2012. And lo and behold, you got the same letter that I got in terms of our information being compromised as federal employees because of a cyber breach. The internet is a great tool for creativity, for communication, for commerce, but it's also become a tool for bad actors engaging fraud, identity theft, piracy, terrorist propaganda, espionage. As Secretary, how will you counter these cyber threats to protect our nation and our families?
Well, obviously, Senator, if confirmed, I mean, I'll get deep into it. In my job as a military person, I understand cyber out there and know what our capabilities are, U.S. capabilities out there. I also know that, you know, 3, 4, 5 years ago, we talked about the United States would not have a peer competitor in cyber for 20 years or 25 years. Now we know that we have some pretty darn close to peer competitors. You know, I was watching something that Secretary Irish Carter started when he first took over at the Defense Department. He started to reach out to the commercial world, Silicon Valley, that kind of thing, to engage them, as opposed to perhaps, or at least to get a report card on how we're doing within the federal government to develop. But there's unbelievable, obviously, talent out there in the civilian sector, and I think at this point in time, everyone realizes that it's in everyone's interest, whether it's personal security or corporate security, certainly U.S. security. Everyone realizes, I think, that that working together makes an awful lot of sense. There are clearly privacy issues and those kind of things that can be, you know, the law that can be would always have to be followed. But I think just more cooperation amongst the private sector and in the federal sector, the state sector, I think that would go a long way to it. But again, I think Ash Carter was onto something in a big way when he started to reach out to the commercial world.
Thank you. I want to turn the attention back to that northern border discussion we had earlier. Agriculture is our largest economic driver in a state like Montana. Canada is our largest export market. We want to make sure, certainly, farmers and ranchers don't have disruptions as they go north and south here as it relates to commerce. But this 5,500-mile-long border that we have on the northern border, we know there's a lot of bad actors out there. They view that northern border as very much a soft underside. And frankly, with the current administration, we've had some challenges with insufficient staffing to make sure that we're protected there to the north. As a secretary, how would you increase Customs and Border Protection officer recruiting, retention, and mitigate some of these staffing shortages without reducing services?
You know, Senator, I think not in the world I came from, there was a time where, back right in the Vietnam period, where we couldn't recruit or retain good service members, mostly because of the morale, mostly because of when other young men and women talked to their brothers, older brothers, say, should I join the armed forces? No, it's not worth it. So an awful lot of the retention and recruiting problem comes as a result of the morale problem within the department. I was just talking to a couple of gentlemen a little earlier who said that they've been lifelong members of the federal law enforcement world, but would not recommend their sons or daughters join up. I have a very good friend. Well, I'll end it there and just say morale, the best recruiters in any organization are the people that are already in the organization. If they value or have a sense that people value what they do, that there's a future, that there's upward mobility, that you get a fair shake no matter who you are in terms of advancement and all, that turns recruitment and retention around. But what I hear mostly is we're not appreciated and we're not allowed to do our job. So we'll take a long, hard look at that right away.
Thank you, General Kelly. Yesterday, we discussed the government earning the trust of the people. DHS's Citizenship and Immigration Services, they play a critical role in vetting refugees. This has become a topic of conversation across our country as well as in Montana. Long before they reach U.S. soil, interviews, background checks, collecting biometric data abroad and so forth. How can the American people regain trust that any future refugee will not be a risk to our families? And what will you do to ensure that there are comprehensive background checks completed?
One of the problems, I think, in with many of our refugees is they're coming from countries, obviously, that are dysfunctional. And I think many American citizens feel that if you're taking in people from a country that simply has no law enforcement bureaucracy, they clearly don't have things like the FBI and Homeland Security, how can you guarantee? There is no guarantee. You can't guarantee 100%, and if you're taking in large numbers of people or any people from places where you really can't vet them very well, I guess you do the best you can.
And lastly, you talk about telling truth to power. How has this integrity served you in making tough decisions as a leader?
It's made it easy, actually. As Secretary Gates said, it's a moral responsibility. It's what you do. And if you don't, I found if you don't, organizations like the United States Senate and House figure very quickly that what they're getting from a witness is not straight. And it certainly kind of marginalizes you. So I think truth to power is the way to go.
Thank you, General Kelly.
Senator Peters.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Kelly, wonderful to have you here, and I'll join everyone else in thanking you for your service and certainly for your family service as well. It is truly a family affair, public service, and particularly for your many years in the U.S. Marine Corps, so I appreciate your patriotism and sacrifice. I also want to say it's good to see you again. I had the privilege of being with you in Guatemala last year, as part of the committee trip, and had the benefit of your briefings, and actually had the benefit of being on the border between Guatemala and Mexico and talking about some of the issues related to immigration from that country and from Latin America as well. And it is certainly very refreshing to see the director or a nominee for the director of Homeland Security as someone who has been on the front line in dealing with those issues. And I also appreciate from your briefings the fact that you understand that this is an incredibly complex issue. It can't be solved simply by building a wall. It requires a much more thoughtful approach, and I'm confident, based on your experience and your statements, that you bring that to the office. I wanted to pick up on what Senator Daines talked about in regards to cybersecurity. As we talked about in our previous conversation, I believe that it, without question, the number one national security threat to us is cyber. Not only the Russian attacks, which you have addressed earlier in the hearing here, but attacks that are occurring on a daily basis. And as you know, a person or entity trying to use cyber to attack us often looks for the weakest link. And that weakest link tends to be entities like small businesses or perhaps local governments or state governments that don't have the same kind of cyber protections that we may have at the federal level, although that is certainly open for attack as well, as we've seen from the past. But last Congress, I joined Senator Vitter in introducing the Small Business Cybersecurity Improvement Act, and it was part of the 2017 NDAA authorization and is now law, that will require the SBA and the DHS to develop a small business development center for cyber strategy. And just want to kind of your thoughts on your support of that endeavor and how you see the DHS working, particularly with small business owners who don't have the resources to have elaborate defenses to protect themselves as well as protect larger networks.
Well, Senator, you know, as you know, part of the mission is to protect the .gov of DHS, protect the .gov nets, and to work with the commercial world. And since it's part of the mission, again, don't know the level of effectiveness. I suspect I know Jay Johnson, good friend, has this on his scope. Don't know to the degree. How successful we're being, but he started for sure this process of outreach, and I'll continue it.
Right. Well, I appreciate that. The other, and I have some direct questions that I'd like to ask that are very important to folks in my state. As we spoke about earlier, I represent a very large Arab American, Muslim American community in the state of Michigan, one of the largest communities outside the Middle East, largest community in the United States. And based on comments made by the president-elect, I will tell you there is a great deal of fear in the community, a great deal of unease about what the future means for them under the new administration. And certainly the Department of Homeland Security is a place where they have particular anxiety. So curious to your position on a couple things. First off, do you agree that putting mosques under generalized surveillance and establishing a Muslim database, two proposals that were discussed by President-elect Trump, would raise serious constitutional issues under the Free Exercise Clause of the First Amendment and the Equal Protection Clause of the Fifth and Fourteenth Amendments?
Not a lawyer, but to the degree I understand those laws, yes, sir.
Will you commit to ensuring that religion does not become a basis for U.S. counterterrorism or law enforcement policy, particularly as it relates to the targeting of individuals with ancestry from Muslim-majority countries?
I don't think it's ever appropriate to focus on something like religion as the only factor, so yes, sir.
And do you believe that non-citizen Muslims, people of Arab or people of South Asian descent should have to register with the government? And if so, for what purpose would the program be used?
I know there was some program some years ago where they had this on the books. I know it's no longer on the books, and I unless
obviously would have to be legal, but unless there was some really compelling reason. But so, yes, sir, I'd agree.
Yeah, I think the program is the NSEER program that you're talking about that began in 2002. And it was supposedly to catch terrorists, existed for a number of years and never had any impact whatsoever. And so it sounds as if you would not be supportive of bringing that back. Sure. Good. The last question is the Supreme Court case, Korematsu versus the United States, was a landmark case addressing the constitutionality of Executive Order 9066, which ordered Japanese Americans into internment camps during World War II, regardless of their citizenship. Do you agree that the Supreme Court decision in Korematsu does not provide a legitimate precedent for internment or special registration of individuals who are Muslim or with ancestry from Muslim-majority countries?
I do. I don't agree with registering people based on ethnic or religion or anything like that. So I think I would agree with the Supreme Court.
Great.
Again, not a lawyer here, so.
Right. But I can understand.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate those responses. And maybe just in follow-up, and I know we talked about this in our meeting earlier, but if you could let the committee know, how do you approach communities in this country who are made up primarily of Arab American, Muslim Americans? From your past experience, how do you see your role as Homeland Security Director in reaching out to those communities and making them part of a solution?
Very briefly, as we discussed in the office, Senator, our success in Iraq, certainly my time in Iraq, was because I outreached with people across the spectrum of society, all of whom were Muslim, followed the Islamic faith. Obviously, the men, the clerics, the communities. The way we won, certainly in my part of Iraq, was we outreached to people, convinced them that we were there for good, not evil. That we were there to protect them and to help them. And overnight, almost, with the awakening and other things that I won't go into, but I mean, it was the thing that gave us success, outreach to the community and in touching everybody in the community and gaining their trust. I know Secretary Johnson does that, and I certainly will continue that. Look forward to continuing that.
Well, I appreciate those responses, General, and if confirmed, we'd love to host you in the Detroit area with a community that would be very eager to meet you and certainly needs reassurance from someone in that position.
Look forward to it, Senator.
Thank you.
Senator Harris.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Johnson and Ranking Member McCaskill. General, thank you for your longstanding service and sacrifice, and to your family as well. I'd like to ask you a few questions, starting with the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, also known as DACA. Hundreds of thousands of DACA recipients around the country are afraid right now for what this incoming administration might do to them, and also what it might do to their unauthorized family members. In order to receive DACA, these young people submitted extensive paperwork to the federal government, including detailed information regarding themselves and their loved ones. They also had to qualify, as you know, for the program. And in qualifying, each person's case was reviewed and determined on a case-by-case basis. The young person must have not been convicted of a felony or a significant misdemeanor or three or more misdemeanors. The young person must also not be deemed to pose a threat to national security or public safety. The young person must currently be in school, have graduated or obtained a certificate of completion from high school, have obtained a general education development certificate, also known as GED, and or have been honorably discharged as a veteran of the Coast Guard or Armed Forces of the United States. Among other things, DACA applicants must submit proof of identity, proof of time and admission in the United States, proof of relevant student, school completion or military status, and biometric information. As part of the DACA application process, we conduct biometric and biographic background checks against a variety of databases maintained by DHS and other federal agencies. If a DACA applicant knowingly makes a misrepresentation or fails to disclose facts in an effort to obtain DACA, it is a felony and the applicant will be treated as an immigration enforcement priority to the fullest extent permitted by law, and be subject to criminal prosecution and/or removal from the United States. This means, obviously, that applicants to DACA know that if they're not giving us the whole truth about their story, they're putting a target on their own backs. At the time, the Department of Homeland Security assured them that it would follow its long-standing practice of not using such information for law enforcement purposes, except in very limited circumstances. These young people are now worried that the information that they provided in good faith to our government may now be used to track them down and lead to their removal. So my question is, do you agree that under DACA, we have, and those young people have relied, by hundreds of thousands of them have relied on our representations. Do you agree with that? That we would not use this information against them?
The entire development of immigration policy is ongoing right now in terms of the upcoming administration. I have not been involved in those discussions. If confirmed, I think I know I will be involved in those discussions. I think there's a big spectrum of people who need to be dealt with in terms of deportation.
I'm speaking specifically of DACA.
And those categories would be prioritized. I would guess, I'm not part of the process right now, I would guess that this category might not be the highest priority for removal. I promise you, Senator, that I will be involved in the discussion.
I'd like that you would read or become familiar with a document issued by the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services. It's Frequently Asked Questions brochure. Question number 20. The question is, if my case is referred to ICE for immigration enforcement purposes or I receive an NTA, will information related to my family members and guardians also be referred to ICE for immigration enforcement purposes? The answer, according to this document, is that if the case is referred to ICE for purposes of immigration enforcement or they receive an NTA, information related to their family members that is contained in their request will not be referred to ICE. Are you willing to maintain that policy of not referring that information to ICE?
I will definitely look very long and hard at the document. I'm not familiar. I don't know right now where the upcoming administration is going. This, I will be part of that. I can tell you, Senator, I promise you that I'll keep a very open mind as we look at this topic.
Are you familiar that under your predecessors, the Director of Homeland Security made the decision and issued the information to the troops? It was not the President. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And do you agree that many of these young people were brought here as children and only know America as their home?
Many of them are in that category.
And do you agree that they are now studying at colleges and universities and graduate schools across our country? Some are working in Fortune 100 companies, major institutions, and businesses, both small and large.
I'm aware that some are, yes.
And do you intend then to use the limited law enforcement resources of DHS to remove them from the country?
I'll follow the law. But again, I go back to we have a limited capacity to execute the law. So we would certainly look at the highest priority activities but I will follow the law to the extent that I can execute the law, if that makes sense.
Well, I know as a career prosecutor, I was formerly Attorney General of California, and before that a district attorney elected 2 terms in office, that we in law enforcement have limited resources. Right. I'm interested in knowing from your perspective where the students and the young people who applied for and were eligible for DACA, where they would fall on your list of priorities in terms of the limited law enforcement resources that you have or would have if confirmed.
I think law-abiding individuals would, in my mind, with limited assets to execute the law, would probably not be at the top of the list.
And would you agree that state and local law enforcement agencies are uniquely situated to protect the public safety of their own communities?
I would agree with that.
And are you aware that state and local law enforcement leaders across the country have publicly stated that they depend on the cooperation of immigrant communities to protect criminal activity and to come forward as witnesses to crime?
I've read that.
And are you aware that there has been, in the past, when the government has applied indiscriminate immigration sweeps, many local law enforcement agencies have been concerned and have complained that there has been a decrease in immigrants reporting crimes against themselves or others?
I was not aware of that.
Will you make it your priority to become aware of the impact on immigrant communities in terms of their reluctance to report crimes against themselves, their family members, or others when they're concerned that DHS may direct sweeps against entire immigrant communities?
Yeah, my commitment. I'll get briefed on this. Again, I fall back on the law will guide me if confirmed in everything that I do.
And I would encourage that not only the law, but how it will practically apply in the streets in terms of the perception of the interpretation of the law to those immigrant communities and what we all want to do, ensuring that all victims of crime, regardless of their document status, are protected and that they receive justice in a court of law.
Acknowledged.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you,
Senator Harris. Senator Paul.
General Kelly, congratulations, and I want to join in also thanking you for your service and your family's sacrifice in defense of our country. The position you're up for, Homeland Security, is obviously to defend the homeland, to defend the country. But the oath you take is actually to defend the Constitution. It's the oath we take. It's the oath you also took in the military as well. And I think that's an important distinction because it doesn't mean we want security at all costs. We want security in order to, you know, have our liberty. So liberty is an important part of this. There have been times in our history when I think we let fear sort of overcome our ability or our desire to defend the Constitution. In the Civil War, we suspended habeas corpus. We kept people in detention, without trial, without legal access. We arrested 3,000 editors during the World War II. 100,000 Japanese were detained. We sort of let our fervor or our fear somehow replace our oath, you know, to defend our liberty, to defend the Constitution. We have on the books, and we passed about 5 years ago, a law that says that an American citizen can be indefinitely detained. Not an American citizen overseas, not someone captured in Syria on a battlefield, someone captured in the United States and accused of terrorism, can be kept indefinitely. They could be sent to Guantanamo Bay, but they could be sent a variety of places. It's never been used, and this president has said he wouldn't use it, but he signed it anyway, much to the chagrin of some of us. But it is on the books. And I guess my question to you would be, do you think we can adequately arrest people in our country who are, you know, somehow a threat to our homeland security? Do you think the Constitution could be good enough, that due process in our courts of law in our country would work? Or would you think, you know, there are going to have to be times when we're just going to have to detain people without trial?
I'm pretty committed to the Constitution. I was not aware of the law. It surprises me. But I think we have enough laws to help us out in that regard.
I think it's important. And, you know, obviously the future is unknown. But you and I have talked about in the office, if something terrible happens, we need people in places of leadership that don't let us succumb to our emotions or our fear, whether they're rational fears of others or whatever they are, that the law is incredibly important. And that's what, you know, our soldiers, you know, sacrifice so much for. With regard to how we collect data on people to protect ourselves, once again, is this idea, well, are we so fearful we're going to collect data on everybody? There have been instances when we have. For example, we've had bulk collection of everyone's phone records. Now, some will argue a technical part of the Fourth Amendment is, oh, well, your phone records are not really protected. Some of us will argue, well, they should be protected. But is this debate we're having? But it's also a debate about sort of how you come to security in our country. Can we come to security by individually going after suspects or for people for whom we are suspicious of? Or should we have blanket surveillance of everyone, which means we have to give up, according to some of us, liberty and privacy? And I'll give you a specific example of this because this comes from the Homeland Security. A couple of years ago, they decided they'd use license plate screeners, and apparently they're very rapid and they can collect hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of license plates an hour. But they decided they would go to a gun show. why this particularly concerns me is you could also conceive of people as a gun show as exercising some sort of freedom of speech or some sort of ideological belief by being at a gun show, not just wanting to buy a gun, but actually defending their Second Amendment right to buy a gun. What alarms me is that if we're going to scan license plates at a gun show, that we might go to a pro-life rally or a pro-abortion rally, depending on who's in charge. I don't want the government scanning people's license plates. I don't want them covering and getting all of our data just so we can possibly be safe someday from something. I want the individual to be protected. But I'm not against Homeland Security going after individuals and digging as deep as you want with the proper process. So what I would ask you is your opinion on how do we defend the country? Can we do it with the traditions of looking at individuals for whom we have suspicion? Or are we going to have to collect all of this data and give up our privacy in the process?
Senator, I would go with the traditional route. The scanning of the license plates, I mean, maybe a reason. I can't think of one right now, but I'm not for the collection or the mass collection of data on people. I'd go the other way.
And this is an amazing amount of information we can look at. If you had all of the information of everyone's visa purchases in the country, there's no end. But realize that this is a big part of what your job is people are going to be coming to you saying, protect us. We want to be safe. But at the same time, what are we willing to give up? Can we keep what we actually believe and what we are as a people? You know, the freedom that you were committed to as a soldier, and I hope you'll keep that in mind.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Paul. Senator Hassan.
Well, thank you, Chairman Johnson and Ranking Member McCaskill. I look forward to working with both of you. And General Kelly, thank you so much for being here today, for your service to your family. I echo the thanks you've heard today for your service and sacrifice. We are very, very grateful. I wanted to just start by asking a question on cybersecurity that's kind of hit my neck of the woods a little bit in the last couple of weeks. 2 weeks ago, the Washington Post reported that a hacking group connected with the Russian government managed to infiltrate the Burlington Electric Power Company in Vermont. And New Hampshire and Vermont, as you know, have many shared utility connections along the border between the two states. I think we all agree that foreign infiltration into our utility infrastructure, into any of our infrastructure, is unacceptable. And with DHS being responsible for securing critical infrastructure from both physical and cyber attack, I'm just curious about what steps you think DHS needs to be taking to prevent cyber attacks on critical infrastructure and confronting foreign nations' cyber espionage efforts.
Yeah, I mean, the best thing we can do, obviously, is just outreach to everybody, whether it's power plants or other commercial interests. The problem, as we discussed, is just it's constant, it's relentless, right. It's from nation states, it's from mafia-type organization, and it's just from vandals. But I think the solution is, A, outreach to provide, offer the protections that exist now. And then, I mean, the threat changes so rapidly we can't keep up with it. We have to find a way, I think, to keep up with it.
Yeah. Thank you. There's been a lot of discussion among committee members about the opioid, heroin, and fentanyl crisis, which is devastating all of our states, but New Hampshire has been particularly hard hit. And there's been excellent discussion, I thought, about the issues on the southern border concerning the fentanyl crisis in particular, too, because that's really changing the way drug dealers are operating, the ease with which fentanyl can be made. The profit margins are huge, and the addictive nature of fentanyl is even greater than other opioids. But one of the things that I am heartened by is your focus on the demand side of this crisis. And it would be, I think, heartening to the people of my state and our country if you can commit on behalf of DHS, should you be confirmed, to partner with this committee, with governors around the country, to really look at the overprescribing of opioids in this country and treat it as the security threat that it is. Is that something you can work with us on and commit to?
I look forward to that, Senator.
Okay. Thank you. I'll add to the Northern Border Chorus, by the way, just to say don't forget us.
Forget, right.
And Lastly, I wanted to focus on one other issue concerning terrorism. Certainly, we are all concerned about the terrorism that is a threat from faraway places. And earlier in your testimony, you indicated that one of your goals would be to keep the terrorists as far away from United States soil as possible. But the nature of the threat is always changing, always evolving. And of late, I think we all agree that there's just been a disturbing rise in homegrown terrorism. And no matter how secure our borders are, terrorist groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda, certainly we know, use the internet to encourage and inspire troubled Americans to carry out violence at home. So how do we go about tackling that particular challenge? And what partners will be most valuable for DHS and the American people in this fight?
Tough problem, to say the least. And as I've discussed with a number of senators, I think it really does start with families and with churches, synagogues, mosques. You know, the homegrown, if you will, terrorists, not just ISIS-inspired. I mean, there are some pretty grim other groups of other nationalities, if you will, you know, white supremacists, that kind of thing. Yeah. But I really do believe it starts with people, parents, you know, understanding what's going on in the bedroom when the son or daughter's in there on the internet all the time. You know, we kind of worry about that they're on inappropriate, you know, porn sites or something. But the fact is that I think that's where it starts in many ways. Who knows why they get disaffected with the country, but that they get on those nets or those websites, and it poisons their mind, I think. And I think in the churches, synagogues, whatever, people hear them talking and should turn them in, or should at least be concerned, talk to their parents. I'm reminded of a young, I think it was a young woman down in the South who was getting radicalized clearly, and her parents noticed it and turned her in to the police. By the same token, there are other examples to where people knew that people were getting radicalized. I think the San Bernardino couple, but people were afraid to raise the red flag because they thought, A, maybe they'll do something to me, and B, maybe I'll be legally, you know, held accountable, legally in the sense of lawsuit or something like that. But it starts there. Clearly, our law enforcement professionals then serve, you know, then a role. But it is a really, really tough nut to crack. I think to the senator's question about engagement with some of the parts of America that have a lot of Arab Americans, Islamic Americans, so that they feel as though they can can report and not be afraid. But I think if we're going to get at this problem at all, it's really energizing communities and families to keep an eye out for the telltale signs, and then to seek help before it gets out of hand. And as I say, in that case that I know of in the South, just before it really got out of hand, they turned the daughter in. It's an act of love to get her help or to get them help. So that's where I am on it, Senator.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you for your service.
Yes, ma'am.
Thanks, Senator Hassan. You may have not been here quite when I welcomed everybody, but again, welcome to the committee. I certainly enjoyed our phone call, and I look forward to working with you. Senator Langford.
General Kelly, thanks again for your service. You've done a remarkable job in your career for the nation, and I appreciate you stepping back out again. And for your family and for all that step out with you, it's a tremendous asset to the nation. You know full well when you were asked by the president-elect to do this that every time there's a problem in an airport, every time there's a shooting, if there's two people across the border, whether north or south, somebody's going to call your phone and say what's not working. So I appreciate you engaging and to do that. Let me give you a couple other optimistic pieces as well as you scan what's happening. We release every year a fumbles report and try to identify different areas. And as you know, DHS has been a major area for morale. That's been discussed several times. Let me give you a couple other pieces of good news. GAO's 2015 review of 22 major acquisition programs at DHS found that only two of the 22 were actually on track. The Inspector General at DHS, in their report, found that DHS's major acquisition programs continue to cost more than expected, take longer to deploy than planned, and deliver less capability than promised. DHS was also identified and has been identified by GAO now for 13 years, not getting up to speed on its human resources programs. That we've now spent $180 million over 13 years just to get an HR program working at DHS. While we've all talked often about some of the issues at the border, which are serious, there are some internal things that are undone. And so while you're focusing on some of these other areas, I would encourage you to assign a deputy to finish the unfinished product of how we handle acquisitions, the cost overruns, and how we handle HR within DHS.
If confirmed, I have my work cut out for me, obviously.
Yes, sir.
There are some great people in the organization, I hope. To retain some of them or to hire others that have been involved in Homeland Security. And I think this is also part of Jay Johnson's, you know, the unity of effort. He has looked into other parts of our bureaucracy and said, how do they do it? Now, no one's perfect, but how do they do it? We have to build probably an acquisition force in DHS. We don't have the same kind of acquisition capability as, say, DOD does. Not perfect, to say the least, but yes, sir, yeah, my commitment.
Yeah, thank you. Let's talk about a couple of things that have been touched on a little bit before. There is an ongoing conversation, obviously, about cyber and cyber attacks into the United States. So two specific areas that I want to bring up with you. One is jurisdictional. Mm-hmm. This committee obviously is very engaged in cyber as a Homeland Security issue. Armed Forces is obviously very involved in that and what's happening with cyber issues, as well as intel. What I'm looking for is some cooperation. Right. In a sense of this is not going to be a jurisdictional fight, and so no one does it. But how do we actually build a sense of teamwork and cooperation between Armed Services, Intel, and DHS, and so we can build a real sense of a cyber doctrine? A cyber doctrine and how we're going to respond to cyber attacks has been discussed now for a decade, right. And it's been met to death, basically, in one meeting after another, but no set of decisions on that. Help me understand how we get to a decision and move on in cooperation with other entities.
I think you'd agree, Senator. The worst thing that this city oftentimes deals with is the stovepipe mentality and the rice bowls and people. In my view, if confirmed, and it's been the way I've operated, I have no rice bowl. If I have to give something up or go cross town to someone else's meeting, I'll do that to improve whatever it is we're trying to improve. There's unbelievably talented people in the U.S. government across the bureaucracies. But my sense is that there's just not enough interaction. Obviously, we can't do certain things because of laws, but laws can be changed if need be. But I think there's a, 10 years ago when we started talking about this, we were probably a little bit ahead of the problem. And 10 years later, we're behind the problem now. I think probably now the time to act. I mean, I think we very, very easily could suffer a catastrophic, a seriously catastrophic cyber event because we didn't do our jobs as the U.S. government. And I think it's probably right now there's an awareness that it's time to sit down and work these things out. And again, I think the commercial world, the civilian world, is as much a player in this as the federal government is.
And I would say this committee is eager to have a partner in that to be able to discuss it, what needs to be done legislatively. There are at times we'll have administrative witnesses here that will say, I can't really give a recommendation to you. When we know the administration officials deal with it all the time, they know the barriers and the issues they face. We need some good cooperation from people to be able to sit down with us and to say, here's what we're bumping up against. Two of the quick areas on this. One of them is working with cities that don't want to cooperate on the issue of immigration, sanctuary cities that have determined we do not want the federal government dealing with individuals that are clearly in the United States illegally and have a criminal record. What are your thoughts on those?
Well, I think as a public servant, if confirmed, I don't think I have the authority to pick and choose what laws need to be followed. I think it's in a lot of ways dangerous to think that you can pick and choose which laws. I understand maybe the perspective of some of the local leaders, but I do think the law is the law, and I think the law has to be followed.
Yes, sir. I would agree. Let me bring up one last thing with you as well, and it's something you and I have talked about before, and that's the Northern Triangle and our good relationship with El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala, and some of their leaders that are really doing a remarkable turnaround. We spoke about Guatemala and the new president, Jimmy Morales, and Thelma Aldana, the attorney general there, and the remarkable work that they're doing. What practically can we do as a nation to help them as we deal with cocaine use, for instance? Around 90% of the cocaine that comes to the United States touches soil first in Guatemala.
Right.
So what can we do to be able to partner with them to deal with interdiction efforts?
Stop the demand.
That's a big one.
If we stop the demand, this would... you're never going to get to zero. We've talked about this, obviously. You never get to zero. But stopping the demand, and we just don't have and never have had a truly comprehensive demand reduction that goes everything from, law enforcement, treatment, rehabilitation, interdiction of large amounts of drug as it's in the flow, working with our partners down south. We've never had a real serious public campaign here in the United States. I testified in this room in April, had some real experts up here about behavior,
right,
modifications, tobacco, Mothers Against Drunk Driving type campaigns. You never get to zero, but we have to reduce the amount of drugs used. 47,000 Americans died last year from drug overdoses. You know, cost America $250 billion. We got to do something.
I would agree. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Langford. Now back to the northern border, Senator Heidkamp.
I deserve that. There's a lot of critics of the northern border here. I'm going to just kind of rapidly go through a number of things that you and I talked about that you know are of great interest. And I think Senator Tester hit on the recruitment, so did Senator Daines. Absolutely critical. We think that DHS has begun a process that can actually result in some successes. Please stay on top of that. We absolutely have to give these folks help. And it's not fair what's happening to a lot of our Border Patrol agents, Customs and Border Protection, who are told literally they cannot move home to other parts of the country or transfer. You're going to lose those folks to other federal agencies who will, in fact, give them an opportunity to move. So it's critical that we pay attention to the workforce. Northern border, pass the bill, sign the bill. We look forward to your analysis, putting your touch on the northern border challenges and issues, and greatly, greatly interested in how that whole thing comes out. Cybersecurity, I joined Senator Langford in saying we hear it coming at us from all different directions. I think historically the Intel Committee has kind of taken a little jurisdiction there, and we don't want a stovepipe or rice bowl. I think you were saying rice bowl. That's a new one to me. We don't want to silo these issues. We want DHS to assert their important role in cybersecurity. Human trafficking. We just did a hearing this morning for the Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations with Backpages. It is a scourge. Obviously, you know that the Blue Campaign is working to train officers, has been absolutely a critical resource for people in my state as we confront the area of human trafficking. Please look at that program. I think there's improvements that can be made, but I will tell you that your officers and investigators within DHS have been critical in advancing the cause of protecting children in this country. Something that I don't think has been raised here, which is first responders. I challenge you to take a look at what's happening with volunteer fire departments. The vast majority of area in this country, the fire protection comes from volunteers. Maybe there's a professional or a paid staff person, but the volunteers provide that service. Having a hard time recruiting volunteers. Some of that goes to equipment. Some of that goes to just losing a culture of volunteerism. Somebody else is going to do it. I think it's critical that you assert your role, and going to ask that you pay attention to our Response Act, which just passed, that would take a look at FEMA's role in training people, especially as it relates to hazardous and flammable material on the rails. I think Senator Hassan was hitting on something very critical on the anti-radicalization. Have you had a chance to visit with the folks within DHS who are working on that program and evaluate what you think of that program and how you change the current program that they have?
I have not. We because of the ingoing, outgoing MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, we can't directly touch.
Okay.
But I'm in there if confirmed.
I just really believe that it is critical.
Sure.
that you bring the expertise of your service historically to that effort. I think that it's a little late in coming, but I think it can be a force for good. And I think it critically important. There's also some local grants to communities who want to bring a collaborative nature, bring people together, build those relationships that hopefully will, number one, prevent radicalization, but certainly report it as a frontline effort. You know, the motto, see something, say something. If the community does not feel appreciated, respected, or is afraid to report something for fear that it will come back to them, that you aren't going to get the intel that you need. I want to spend just a little bit of time talking about the Northern Triangle. I like to tell, and I think I should tell your wife, the excuse he gave me is you no longer wanted him underfoot. I don't know. But we're extraordinarily grateful, and you must be extraordinarily proud, both his daughter and his wife. This is a remarkable public servant. But one of the reasons why I believe that DHS won the cabinet lottery, and you can tell from perhaps this a love fest that we're having with you today, is that is that you have such a breadth of experience in an area that is very challenging to our southern border and really our entire border security. Your work at Southcom is critical. You told me that very many of those Latin American leaders called you and were very excited. That gives us a real opportunity. But one of the things that I think we have missed as we look at the rush of the children to the border is the opportunity that we have to work with organizations like the Organization of American States and UNHCR, who are trying to deal with the people fleeing violence in those communities and in those countries, and refugee in place, by helping Belize, by helping Nicaragua, by helping southern Mexico, by helping Costa Rica, who has taken a fair number of these refugees into their community. Have you had a chance to take a look at those efforts regionally to look at helping people out of violence, but also then stabilizing communities? And are you at all concerned about blanket statements about nation building and whether that's going to restrict or in any way hamstring your ability to bring a different perspective to the Northern Triangle?
Well, Senator, first thing I'd offer, when in Southcom and for my entire career, every discussion really began and ended with human rights and a discussion of human rights. I had a very good relationship up here in Washington, and every time I visited a country, I would make it a point to meet with the local human rights groups, because you get a far different view of what's needed, what the real conditions are from the local human rights people. I'd make the same comment about the church leadership in that part of the world. Of course, it's overwhelmingly Roman Catholic with a very sizable evangelical Christian. Worked, met with those people. Oftentimes, maybe most of the time, the NGOs and organizations like that have a very, very good, a better view and a way ahead that's worth listening to. I spent an awful lot of time with them, so I'm totally in. But at the end of the day, really, to use an overused term, it's really improving the security on the ground and investment. Not just more money to, you know, investment monitored in the right way by the right organizations. The Inter-American Development Bank is a particularly good one in that part of the world. I'm not suggesting we give them money. I'm suggesting we rely on them to tell us how to invest that money.
But it is a tough, tough problem, and it comes back to the incredible profits that flow out of our country because of the use of drugs. You know, the average American who uses drugs, you say recreationally, doesn't think there's anything wrong with it. The Latins will tell you this, you know, because of your recreational use or your abuse, thousands and thousands of Latins die every year that shouldn't die. And I just wish we had a campaign to make people understand that there's no such thing as a nonviolent use of drugs.
Thank you so much. And again, thank you so much to your family and to you for your long service and your continued service to our country.
Thank you, ma'am.
Senator Hoeven.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was presiding on the floor from 3 to 4, so one of the good things about coming late is that you get to hear all the testimony and the answers to the questions. One of the bad things is you end up last in line. But it's, again, I want to add my thanks to you for your service to the military, and for your willingness to serve again, and your family, too. And you bring great experience. Thanks for coming by the office today and engaging in conversation about this important position. You know, I kind of want to start off. I come from the funding side, so I've chaired the Appropriations Committee for Homeland Security for the last 2 years, and particularly in terms of results. So talk to me, if you would, for a minute about how do we make sure that we've secured the border and we're measuring results so that we know exactly what's going on and that we communicate those results to the people of the country so they understand what's going on.
Well, I think the two things, Senator, that two ways to measure it would be, and my law enforcement friends tell me that if you, in the case of drugs that come in the three, frankly, I'm not arguing for legalization of marijuana here. I'm just saying that the only drugs I really ever concerned myself with at Southcom were the three hard drugs. All the marijuana flow that we saw was coming from some of the Caribbean islands south. So I just focus on the hard drugs. They will tell you that if you have an effective law enforcement strategy, I would argue border strategy, you'll start to see the cost of drugs go up. They're dirt cheap now, but kind of a supply and demand thing. If you can reduce the availability, and that's one way to the street price of drugs. You know, it's interesting, a kilo, retail kilo, not street value cut down, but a kilo in Washington, D.C. here costs about $40,000. A kilo in most of the rest of the world costs about $250,000, and that's because of the business aspect of the movement. But the point is, the law enforcement people say, if you see the price going up, then you're doing something right. And in terms of the illegal movement of people, fewer people come in. You know, it's... In a way, it's anyone's guess how many, you know, there's a certain number that we pick up, but is anyone's guess how many actually get through? But, you know, I think there's some pretty good metrics that you could use, a range of people that get through, a range of people that are being processed in the legal deportation route. But I think that those two things, how many you're actually grabbing at the border, would be one metric. How many people internally? How many people are apprehended and enter the process of deportation, or at least the legal process, and then the price of drugs? I think those would be pretty good metrics.
So, are you willing to commit to provide those metrics so that we truly have an understanding of what's going on at the border, both the southern border and the northern border, but then also our international airports and seaports, right. The issue of visa overstays. The work we need to do to make sure that E-Verify is mandatory so we truly have an understanding of who's coming, who's coming in, who's being detained at the border, and what's the resolution of someone that's detained. I mean, are you committed to providing those statistics so we all have a common understanding of what's factually going on?
Certainly committed, Senator, but I think also, if confirmed, I'm going to get into how accurate the numbers are in the first place. You know, we're working with numbers. If you talk to people about the amount of cocaine, as an example, that is produced in the three countries that produce it, you know, you have the spectrums like this. I'm told that, 200 tons at the most, but I got 200 tons last year at Southcom. The Colombian's got 158 tons or 100 something like that. So there's wild estimates as to what the numbers are, whether it's people, whether it's drugs. So yes, the commitment is there, and also a commitment to try to get, much of this data comes from DEA, FBI, to try to clues together and come up with better numbers so we really know what we're dealing with. But yes, sir, you have my commitment.
How do you make sure you secure the border? Talk in terms of the wall, in terms of technology, in terms of people. How do you make sure we have a secure border?
Perhaps the most important thing right now, as I've heard, and again, this is not briefed out of Homeland Security. We're not talking to them right now. But anecdotally, but it's a lot of anecdotal, is allowing the great men and women that are in the law enforcement business of DHS, particularly down on the border, allow them to do the job according to the law. I had an interesting experience just a few months ago. I was down on the border in El Paso, off active duty, working for the Department of Defense down there, looking at some things. And I was talking to some Border Patrol men and women, five of them on the border. And maybe 200 yards down, there's a big fence there, call it a wall. I mean, it's pretty substantial. It's not a chain link fence. It's 18 feet tall and pretty seriously constructed. But I saw, you know, half a dozen or so people jump over the fence. And I'm standing there just expecting the officers to jump in their cars, put their lights on, and dash down there. And they said, what's the use? I was surprised. That's not good for morale. So I think the number one thing right now would be, in accordance with the law, let the people who are tasked to protect the border do the job.
So the need to really empower the people, Customs and Border Patrol.
I mean, the laws are there, as I understand it. No one says the laws aren't there that I talk to. Again, very anecdotal, kicking the tires. But we ought to be allowed to do our job.
Touch for a minute on UAS, unmanned aerial systems, both in terms of using them on the border as part of the technology effort, but then also counteracting them, defense in terms of, you know, other countries or penetration by other technologies.
Well, the beauty of the UAS is you know, they're low maintenance, relatively low cost, and they don't get tired, they don't complain. There's no one riding around. It's pretty good stuff. One of the things I did in Central America was encourage. They thought they needed air forces. They don't need air forces. They can't afford them. And we got them going down the route of looking at UASs. It's a relatively cheap solution for observation purposes. The other part of your question about the opposition.
Well, counteracting. One of the things we've done is set up test sites to develop UAS. We're using them on the border. We need to do more of that. But then we also need to have the ability to counteract any type of UAS coming in or penetrating our system or creating a security breach?
Well, one of the things, I haven't been briefed in any way or any discussions on their use, say the cartel's use of UASs, but they do use the ultralights to cross the border. That's another problem. They're very hard to detect. But again, there are ways to pick these things up. I'm not completely conversant on the technologies that they use to go after these ultralight aircraft. But will be, if confirmed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it very much. And again, General, thanks to you for your service
Thank you.
For your willing to serve again.
Well, thanks, Senator Hovind. And again, welcome to both you and Senator Harris. Appreciate you asking some great questions. I think what you just witnessed here, General Kelly, is what certainly I've experienced in my 6 years on this committee. A committee of people that, again, we share the same goal as you do. You know, we share your mission, keeping this nation safe and prosperous and secure. And we don't do show trials here. We treat witnesses with respect. I reserve my question time, but the committee members asked a lot of great questions, so I won't hold you any further. Just last couple points. Every one of these hearings that we hold, from my standpoint, is all about laying out a reality. You know, try and describe a problem, try and go to the root cause, just lay out the reality situation. I think the reality that we exposed in this hearing is that, as Senator Heidkamp alluded to, we have the pleasure, the privilege, the honor of holding a hearing to confirm an extraordinary American, somebody that we are all incredibly appreciative of the fact that you are willing to answer the call one more time, your family is willing to support you. So again, I want to thank you. I want to thank Karen and Kathleen and Jake, your son John, who couldn't attend. Just thank you for serving. You know, our commitment to you is we want to help you succeed in your commission, in your mission. We made that same commitment to Secretary Jay Johnson. I want to wish him well. I think we all had a great deal of respect for the job he did. He led the effort, unity of effort. And I appreciate the fact in your answers, you also are committed to that unity of effort. I think it's extremely important. I just spoke with Senator McCaskill. We would kind of like to see a unity of your responsibility reporting to Congress as well. I know it's a real snarl here, all these agencies with different committees. We'll do what we can to try and at least streamline that so you can concentrate on your important mission of keeping this nation safe and secure. So again, I just want to thank you for your willingness to serve. General Kelly has made financial disclosures and provided responses to biographical and pre-hearing questions submitted by this committee. Without objection, this information will be made part of the hearing record, with the exception of the financial data, which are on file and available for public inspection in the committee offices. This hearing record will remain open until 5 p.m. tomorrow, January 11th, for the submission of statements and questions for the record. This hearing is adjourned. Thank you.